Dear friends, welcome to this question-answer series presented by Dr. Johnson C. Philip. Dr. Philip has spent his whole life answering young and old on an unbelievably wide range of subjects. His ultimate aim is to help you to find answers to your questions and even doubts. In turn, this will help you in multiple ways. Dr. Philip keeps posting question answers regularly. Many of these can be very helpful to you. Do not miss any of them. Please subscribe to our channel and you will get notice of each and every video as it is posted. It is easy to subscribe. Below this video you will see a subscribe icon. Please click it. Please also click the bell icon there to confirm your subscription. That is all. You will never miss any of these life-transforming videos. God bless you.
Let's go to cults. As I mentioned last time, cults are groups which are trying to steal people from main or Christian mainstream. Let me use the word Christian mainstream. Yes. We evangelical Christians, we go around the world and going around the world, we share the gospel with non-Christians and lead them into the Christian faith. Most of the cults don't do that. What most of the cults do is they come to Christian churches and they steal people from us. So because of that, cults are dangerous. And as I said, the word cult has a broad meaning, and therefore the correct expression to be used is false cults. Instead of going into the world and evangelizing people, false cults do two things. Number one, they steal Christians from other churches and take into their groups. And number two, they claim that we are not Christians, rather they are true Christians. This is a cult characteristic that all of us should keep in mind. Last 2 weeks, I probably hinted that some cultistic groups have their eyes upon this city where I am, and that they are planning to steal away a lot of young people from our churches, and that many young people are already ready to join them. So I had many questions from several of you to identify those groups and also to identify their beliefs. Unfortunately, these groups, they have not revealed much about them to the Christian mainstream or to the brethren mainstream. They are working surreptitiously among our young people, and these young people are not revealing much. Also, these groups, they have so far not revealed their statement of faith. So since everything is taking place very secretly, at present, I cannot make any definitive statements about their names, their places of worship, or their doctrines. Dr. Sanishirian and I, we are carefully studying their movements, and whatever they reveal about them, once sufficient information is available, we will present an analysis. Till then, since we ourselves are in dark, we would ask you to keep waiting till we have enough information. Today, I would like to begin with cult classification. Why classification? Now, that's a question. Why classification? Because today there are so many cults of so many varieties that it's practically impossible to remember all of them by names. And therefore, if all the cults that are working around us, if they can be divided into, say, 2, 3, or 4 categories, it's far more easy to remember. And that's the value of cult classification. Also, when we have a proper classification, then it is easier to remember. For example, if something is a Christian cult, then they all have something common. If something is an occult cult, then though they all might be different, there are few things which are common among them. So classification is very useful, number one, to remember, and number two, to know the common characteristics so that we can handle them carefully. I was just waiting for the audio to be muted. Let me mention the major groups. Number one, Christian cults. Number two, non-Christian cults. Number three, secular cults. Number four, occult cults. Number five, New Age cults. And number six, super cults. So all the hundreds upon hundreds of cults around us can be put into roughly 6 categories. And if we understand these 6 categories and the major characteristics of these 6 categories, then it becomes easy to sort of study cults and also to spot them. So let me, for the sake of those who entered just now, let me tell you, or there are hundreds of cults, they can be classified into 6 groups. 1, Christian cults. 2, non-Christian cults. 3, secular cults. 4, occult cults. 5, New Age cults. And 6, super cults. Super cult is a new classification because super cult is a very new phenomenon which manifested itself only in 1970s. And most of the super cults manifested themselves in India, and that's the reason why there has been a delay in identifying and classifying them, because we Indians, even if we see something that is evil, particularly we brethren, we become hypocritical followers of Mahatma Gandhi. Don't see anything that is evil, don't listen to anything that is evil, and don't speak anything evil. We are all related to each other, and the leader of the nearby cult may be my brother-in-law or brother-in-law's brother, and therefore I should not speak lest there be family conflict. And that's the reason why there was a delay in classifying super cults. But they are now a very major force in India, and from India they have spread worldwide, and therefore it is necessary for us to know super cults also. So this way, cults can be classified into 6 different groups. Number one, this group is the most commonly known group to us, Christian cults. They are called Christian cults because though they are false cults, they have a lot of things common with us. They use Bibles in their churches. They use the name of Lord Jesus Christ. They also claim that they are true Christians. And there are a lot of similarities between them and mainstream churches. I'm not talking about mainline churches such as Jacobites, Marthomites. I'm using a different expression. By mainstream, I mean brethren, Baptists, local churches. So these cults are known as Christian cults because they are very similar to mainstream Christianity or evangelical Christianity, and they claim to be the real evangelicals. This includes Jehovah's Witnesses, known to most of you. Seventh-day Adventists, known to most of you. Jesus only, known to many of you. Children of God, known to many of you. And then there are any number of groups, many of them known to you, many of them unknown to you. They are known as, once again, let me remind you, they are known as Christian cults because they claim to be evangelical in faith, but they are not. We will look at them individually when the Lord allows us, but please remember, Jehovah's Witnesses, Seventh-day Adventists, Jesus only, Children of God, and all of these are Christian cults. Number two, non-Christian cults. Now you may say, well, if they are non-Christian, they must be non-Christian religions. No, they are not non-Christian religions. They differ from the mainline non-Christian religions in many, many ways. And that's why they are known as cults, because they take people from non-Christian religions and also from Christian or from Christian community. These include the Hare Rama, Hare Krishna movement. Many of you who are in the US, you have heard about ISKCON, International Society for Krishna Consciousness. They are a big force in the US. They are actually a cult among the Hindus. And though it is a Hindu cult, they take people from Hindus. They have millions of devotees from mainline Christian churches in the USA and Europe. Then there is a group which follows what is known as Osho, Osho communes. The group of Osho was founded by a man from Jabalpur, Madhya Pradesh, widely known as Acharya Rajneesh. And when the name Rajneesh was connected with a lot of scandals, he changed the title to Osho. Osho is a Japanese title, and it probably means the enlightened one. Rajneesh is no more, but the cult is still very, very much alive and thriving, particularly in the US. Then many of you might have heard about the Brahma Kumaris. They are very active in 150 countries. They come from Hindus, but they do not identify themselves as Hindus. They take people away from Hinduism, and they also take people away from other religions, including mainline Christianity, and that's how they have spread into 150 countries. Then there is a smaller non-Christian cult known as Radha Swami or Radha Swami Satsang, basically Hindus, but still there is much distinction between them and Hindus. Then there is another cult known as the Qadianis. This is a Muslim cult. The leader of the Qadiani cult, he claims that he is Lord Jesus Christ. This group is very active in India and also in Pakistan. They claim that Lord Jesus did not die on the cross, but that he came to India, he got married, and he lived up to the age of 120, and that he was buried in Kashmir. They even point to a grave in Kashmir and claim that this is the grave where Lord Jesus was buried. They fight a lot against Christians. Their magazines contain a lot of articles against Christians. They claim that they are real Muslims, or they are the real Muslims, but Muslims consider them as a cult, as non-Muslims. They are put here as in the category of cults because they have much to do with the Christian faith. They speak a lot about and against the Christian faith. So this way, the first category of cults is Christian cults. The second is non-Christian cults. And then we also have some secular cults. Secular means there is no religion. If there is no religion, why do you call them cult? Because they promise a lot of things which are promised by religion also. The most prominent secular cult is Marxism. Marxism promises everything which the Christian faith promises. And Marxism has eventually spread into a large number of forms, and as a result, it has infiltrated the Christian faith. And I'm sure that many of you have known as many of you have heard about liberation Christianity or liberation theology. That's actually Marxism. Liberation theology is actually Marxism baptized, or Marxism in Christian clothing. There are many other secular cults, and we will look at some of them, Lord willing, when we come into their details. Then comes a very dangerous category. The fourth category of cults is occult cults. I'm sure many of you have heard the word occult. Occult actually means hidden. And occult cult means those cults that have a lot of hidden secrets known only to members of that cult. Let me mention some of the occult cults. One is astrology. Please remember, astrology is of many kinds. And some branches of astrology, they fall into the category of occult cult because they tell about future with the help of demons and demon worship. Another occult cult is white magic. White magic is something which many of you have seen, but many of you don't understand. Many, many of these charismatic preachers, they do a lot of things in the name of Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, I command Jesus. Jesus, heal him. It is not Lord Jesus Christ, the historical Lord Jesus Christ of the Bible. For them, Jesus is only a mantra, a magic word. And a lot of these people who pray in the name of Jesus, actually what they are doing is white magic. Then there is gray magic. Gray magic deals with those areas where man develops his hidden powers. And using his hidden powers, he does a lot of things. I'm sure many of you have heard about hypnotism. A more powerful form is mesmerism. They all fall into the category of gray magic, where man develops his hidden powers, which are not to be developed and with which we should not play. Then comes black magic. And black magic is a word that many of you have heard, or most of you have heard. All this witchcraft and things related to that, they come into the category of black magic. Surprisingly, black magic is very, very common among charismatics. Many of you have heard about Benny Hinn. If you have not seen his videos, I strongly recommend that you should see at least one video where he just waves his hand, or he beats people with his hand from a distance and people fall down. In India, people who do black magic in the name of Christianity is common, very common. And people everywhere are falling down when they wave their hand, when they lay their hand upon the head of people. And one peculiar thing about black magic used by charismatic preachers is that people always fall backwards. I'm saying this because by chance, if you are able to see a video after this class, please note it down. They all fall backwards. There is something very peculiar about that, because in the Old Testament, when the Holy Spirit came and people fell under the influence of the Holy Spirit, they all fell forward in a worshipful posture. These people all of them fall backward or sideward, but never in a prostrate situation or prostrate form. So black magic is very common, and within black magic, a lot of branches are there. People look into a crystal and tell about your future. In Malayalam, Mashinotam. There is also, within black magic, there is something known as necromancy. Necromancy means doing things with the help of dead bodies. In India, there is a cult known as Tantric cult. They go to places where dead bodies are either burnt or buried, and when nobody is looking, they take away the dead body, and using the dead body, they do many of their practices. That is known as necromancy. Necros means death. Then there is also spiritism. Now, this is something about which you should pay special attention. Spiritism is a very wide field where they claim that we are doing things with the help of the spirit. What spirit, if you ask them? If it is a Christian who is indulging in spiritism, he will say we are doing it with the help of the Holy Spirit. If it is a Hindu, he will say we are doing with the help of the universal spirit. Spiritism is very dangerous. So dangerous that many, many, many brethren were practicing spiritism. We will come to that later. The modern mother of spiritism should be known to you, because she will appear in many places in this study. Her name is Alice Bailey. Alice Bailey, the modern mother of spiritism, started Lucifer Trust in 1922. And when a lot of people objected against the name Lucifer, she changed it to Lucius Trust. Lucius is the Latin form of Lucifer. She wrote approximately 65 books with the help of a demon known as Dhvaj Kul. And in all these books, she made it very clear that God, the Jehovah of Bible, is man's enemy, and that Lucifer is man's real friend, and that we should destroy the worship of God, Jehovah, and we should bring the worship of Lucifer into churches. She mentioned churches because her work was mostly in a Christian country. In 1922, the USA was a country with a strong evangelical Christian force. So she greatly emphasized that God the Jehovah should be destroyed and Lucifer should be put on throne in churches, and then only will there be peace. And surprisingly, today, even among brethren, there are people whose loyalty is towards the Lucifer Trust and not to Lord Jesus Christ. We will come to that later. The fifth category of cults is New Age cults. New Age cult or New Age cults came into existence in 1960s. These New Age cults came into existence as a result of Alice Bailey. Alice Bailey actually started an occult cult. But she was so careful and so cunning that eventually it changed its form. I'm sure that many of you have seen how butterflies emerge. Initially, the butterfly lays an egg, and out of that egg comes a very horrible creeping thing. It's beautiful. The designs on it are beautiful, but when it creeps, it gives you a creepy feeling. Very soon it becomes a cocoon, shapeless, colorless. But after a fixed period, a beautiful butterfly emerges out of that cocoon, which has no similarity with the cocoon, which has no similarity with the creeping caterpillar, which has no similarity with the eggs laid by the original butterfly. In the same way, out of the eggs laid by Alice Bailey came a creeping thing. That's when she changed the name from Lucifer Truss to Lucius Truss to hide it. Lucius Truss was the cocoon. And out of the cocoon came the beautiful. That means, by beautiful, what I mean is a movement which is so deceptive in appearance, that beautiful New Age movement. And New Age movement gave rise, first of all, to the hippie movement. Any man can lie with any woman. If it gives you pleasure, then it cannot be wrong. If it feels good, it cannot be wrong. And I'm sure many of the seniors in this group remember the hippie movement. Many of you were in the US when the hippie movement sort of broke ground and suddenly spread everywhere. So deceptive is New Age movement that even some of the best American preachers, even they came under the influence. One is Billy Graham. Dr. Billy Graham came under their influence and he started growing his hair. I still remember those pictures. And when somebody asked him why he was doing, he said, I believe that the Jesus movement is going to stay here. Jesus movement was the Christian counterpart of the secular hippie movement. And then Josh McDowell, who has written Evidence That Demands a Verdict, volumes 1 and 2, and also many other good Christian books, he also started growing his hair exactly like these Jesus people. And Jesus people were hippies, only Christian in name. So New Age cults, they are so dangerous that they appear like a butterfly, but they are really that creepy thing. So New Age cults, number one, hippie movement. It came, once again, let me tell you, it came from Alice Bailey of the Lucifer Trust. Two cults that eventually came from Alice Bailey and spread among brethren. One is pranic healing. Many of you probably heard about pranic healing. Another thing which spread among the brethren was Prajapati sacrifice. Third thing, which was very popular in America and which came to India and which was continually advertising in Indian newspapers, is the cult of the Maitreya, one man by the name of Benjamin Creel. He was an American. And in 1970s, he started advertising even in Indian newspapers that Christ is here. And the Maitreya cult is also a product of New Age movement. But these days, I don't hear much. He was already a very old man, and I guess he is no more. But the Maitreya cult is already here, widespread. So this was the fifth. Let me remind you once again. Christian cults, non-Christian cults, secular cults, occult cults, new age cults, and then from the new age cults, there was another development, and this development took place in 1980s and 90s, and that development or that movement can be called as a super cult. They are called as super cult because cults were taking people away from Christianity. They were stealing people from Christianity. But that was dangerous because if you steal people from Christianity, Christians will become alert. So many, many, many of these cults changed their color, changed their way of operation, and instead of pulling people out of churches, they started to infect churches and grow from inside the churches, like a tumor, or like a cancer, or like a virus, which grows inside the body. They started growing inside the Christian churches, infecting them, growing inside them, using the resources of the body. See, how do viruses multiply? Viruses, they do not have multiplication power. Viruses are not living beings. Let me remind you. Viruses, they use human bodies multiplication mechanism to multiply. Bacteria have their own multiplication capacity. Bacteria take energy from human body and multiply. Viruses do not have multiplication power, so they use our human body's multiplication system inside cells to multiply. But whether it is bacteria or viruses inside the human body, they sap our energy to multiply. Similarly, anything that grows inside the human body to destroy it, it takes its energy from us. And since it is inside us, destroying it becomes very difficult. In the same way, many of the cults finally found that instead of pulling people out of the churches, it is better to present their doctrines in such a cunning manner that they are able to get into the churches and grow inside the churches. New Age movement was one of the first to infect churches. And once they infected churches, they were able to take a lot of intelligent people captive into their net. Of the super cults, which brethren people know, one is Prajapati super cult. Number two, Pranic Healing super cult. Number three, Life Renewal Seminar, LRS, super cult. Then Smithism, Punanism, super cult. Then there is Neo-Calvinism. Many of you have heard about Calvinism. Calvinism and Neo-Calvinism are not the same. They have the same roots. Neo-Calvinism is a very dangerous super cult which has spread not only among the brethren, they have spread among the Baptists, they have spread among Presbyterians. And they are filthy rich people. And therefore, many of you who are from USA, you should notice that some of the biggest ministries in America, they can get funding only if they pay lip service to Neo-Calvinism. They have infected churches worldwide. And in the last 20-25 years, there has been an attempt to infiltrate the brethren assemblies. They have not been successful so far. Dr. Sanishwaryan and I, we have written an English book, which is available in Malayalam also by the title of Neo-Calvinism. And Lord willing, as we come to Neo-Calvinism, we will post that book in the Brethren Theological Institute group. Those of you here who are not yet members of the Brethren Theological Institute group, let me remind you one thing. You may have seen notice of this meeting somewhere in some WhatsApp group. That notice came from me. Look at my phone number. Save my number. Send me a request. I will add you to the Brethren Theological Institute group, where now we are going to post a lot of resources and a book in English and also Malayalam on Neo-Calvinism will be available. Book on Pranic Healing will be available. Book on Prajapati will be available. Book on Life Renewal Seminar will be lots of books will be available. Most of them in English, some of them in English and also in Malayalam, and a few in English, Malayalam, and in Hindi. And therefore, brothers and sisters, if you are not a member of the BTI group, Brethren Theological Institute group, you must join that group to get latest notices and latest downloads. One of the speciality of our ebooks is that they are specifically designed for easy reading on smartphones. You can download these books onto your smartphone in 2 minutes and read them comfortably. So good is the design based upon modern principles of design. Okay. Among super cults, one which now has a very heavy influence among brethren and also Baptist and also local churches is Christian rationalism. This name is never mentioned. The Christian rationalists are very, very cunning people. They never identify themselves as Christian rationalists, but they are everywhere among the brethren, like bacteria in our body, which are everywhere from our mouth up to or from our head up to our toe, there are bacteria. In the same way, today, Christian rationalist super cult is everywhere in brethren assemblies and in all similar churches. So these are the six groups about which we should know. A few people came late. I will not go into all the details. For their sake, let me tell you, we were discussing cult classification. Cults can be classified into six. One, Christian cults. Two, non-Christian cults. Three, secular cults. Four, occult cults. Five, New Age cults. And six, super cults. Things are not easy as many of us think. Let me remind you, things are very bad. And now from Christian cults up to super cults, they are trying to steal people from our churches. And unless we take care, more and more young people, and not even older people, will be stolen from our churches. Today, I would like to bring to your attention a passage from 1 Samuel chapter 13. 1 Samuel chapter 13. Many of us have read this portion dozens upon dozens of times, but we have overlooked the significance of this passage for the Jews and also for the Christian church. 1 Samuel 13, 5 onward says, "And the Philistines gathered themselves together to fight with Israel. 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen and people as the sand which is on the seashore in multitude. And they came up and pitched in Michmash eastward from Bethaven." Please remember, 30,000 chariots. Not a small number. 6,000 men on horse. Obviously, if there are 6,000 of cavalry and 30,000 of chariots, the rest of the people would be countless. And that is what the scripture says. People as a sand which is on seashore. How do you fight against such an enemy? Number one, you need God on your side. Number two, you should have warriors. And when you have warriors, they should have implements of battle. If somebody is coming with a machine gun that can fire 300 bullets per minute, you cannot fight against that man with 5 stones the way David did. If they come with machine guns, you also need machine guns, preferably far more superior than their machine guns. These people came against God's people. Okay. Now, God's people, the men of Israel, what did they have? Sixth verse. When the men of Israel saw that they were in a strait, that means they were in a distress or distressful situation, because the people were distressed, then the people did hide themselves in caves and in thickets and in rocks and in high places and in pits. So when the enemy came, he came with full force, and the people of God who were supposed to guard their nation, because God had given them clear instruction that those who rule people, they should see to it that people are guarded properly. What happened? They were distressed. They hid themselves. And where did they hide? They hid themselves in caves. Most foolish thing, because when an enemy realizes that there are a lot of people inside a cave, they would simply set fire at the mouth of the cave and all of them will perish. They hid themselves in caves, in thickets. You just put fire to the thicket, they will perish. And in rocks, again, you throw some fire there, they will be burnt. And in high places, people can easily chase you and reach high places. Pits, what a stupid thing. People can easily put dry leaves on you, dry twigs on you, put fire and you will be dead. So people of God, instead of fighting the enemy, they were running away. And in this process of running away, they were foolishly putting them in places where they were more exposed to danger and death. Brothers and sisters, today, we in the Brethren Assemblies mainly, because the majority of people who are attending, they are from Brethren. There are one or two from outside Brethren Assemblies who follow identical doctrines. Those churches are also facing the same danger. The enemy is coming with full force, chariots, cavalry, all battle equipment, trained men, trained in battle, countless men. We are running and hiding ourselves in caves where killing us is very easy. In thickets where putting fire is very easy, in rocks where killing is very easy, high places where chasing and killing is easy, and in pits where killing is easy. That is the condition of the brethren today. Seventh verse, and some of the Hebrews went over Jordan. That means they ran over Jordan to the land of Gad and Gilead. And as for Saul, yet in Gilgal. See, Saul was a ruler. It was his responsibility to appoint spies who would go all around keep an eye on the movement of the enemy, assess the strength of the enemy, and prepare soldiers for battle in proportion to that of the enemy, and pray to the Lord that the Lord would be with the army of his people. Depending upon the Lord alone was not sufficient. God had made it very clear that they had to do their preparation. But he was not prepared. He was still in Gilgal. And all the people followed him. No, that is not what the Bible says. All the people followed him trembling. Why were they trembling? Number one, Saul did not have a proper defense system. Since he did not have a proper defense system, he did not have a network of spies. And since he did not have a network of spies, he did not have proper information about enemy movement. And since he did not have proper information about enemy movement, he did not know about the strength of the enemy. He did not know about the arms and ammunition used by the enemy. And therefore, his own people were not ready for battle. It was a problem with the leadership. God appointed leaders in the Old Testament to lead his people. Saul was the first king. But even before kings were appointed, God did appoint judges, prophets, even prophetesses to lead the people against their enemies. So the moment people of God were in Canaan, God had appointed it that they should be ready for battle. In fact, the moment they crossed Jordan and entered Canaan, they started their battles. They had trained men. Even in wilderness, if we read Old Testament history properly, we would understand that even in wilderness, they had military training. And that's the reason why even in wilderness, their enemies were not able to fight against them. Divine providence and protection was definitely there. But before divine providence works, God requires that we do our part faithfully. So even in wilderness, they had trained armies. Then they entered the first town and they kept on moving from town to town, winning the whole of Canaan. They had armies. And then came the time of judges. They had armies. And many of these judges were able to use these armies to fight against invaders. Jephthah is a good example. Therefore, finally, when God converted them into a monarchy, it was the responsibility of each and every monarch to take care of his country, number one, by appointing spies who would keep an eye on all the enemies and their strength and their preparation and also their move against the people of God. But here we see that though Saul was appointed the first monarch, he failed in his duty. People with him were trembling. Let me ask you one thing, my dear brothers and sisters. Today, when an enemy of faith speaks against the brethren movement, speaks something against the doctrines which we hold so dear, what is our response? Yesterday I had mentioned a story. Some years ago, a Pentecostal editor wrote two articles against brethren, specifically He mentioned the Brethren Church. He's a friend of mine, very good friend of mine. He was a friend then, he was a friend today. Lot of Brethren people said that a reply has to be given. But many, many senior editors of that magazine said, no, we will not write, we will not write, we will not write. Why? We have many Pentecostal friends. We don't want to offend them. Finally, it was I who wrote that article almost 25 years ago. I mentioned my friend by name and wrote this article. And in Hindi, they say, Kaan pakad liya. All his friends went and said, hey man, you should not have picked up a fight with Johnson. And he said, okay, I'll never write against the Brethren. He never wrote any article after that. Very fine young man. We are very good friends. Even today, we are very good friends. I was not afraid of him. That's why I wrote. Did not destroy our friendship. And even if it destroyed our friendship, I was determined that I wouldn't allow him to attack the Brethren. That is where the problem comes. Today, when somebody attacks a Christian faith, the immediate response is, hey, he's my brother-in-law's brother-in-law, or he's my father-in-law's brother-in-law, or he's my uncle's cousin, and therefore I cannot speak. That was the problem at the time of Saul. Leadership, which was entrusted with protecting the people of God, the leadership was sleeping. It's very widespread among the Brethren. You may ask Johnson, brother, are you attacking the leadership of Brethren churches? Listen, I'm the elder of an assembly. And an assembly in formation. Before that, I was elder of two assemblies. And therefore, I'm not talking about others. I'm talking about myself, my category. More and more of our sheep are being stolen from churches. The leadership is responsible, not the sheep. I remember when, approximately, I think it was 10 or 12 years ago, when I wrote against LRS Supercult. It was a joint book by me and Dr. Senish Chiria. When we released that book, lot of Brethren people wrote to me, brother, brother, they are our people, they are our people, don't write against them. See, they have no consideration. Those who bring wrong teachings in our midst, they don't have a consideration. But we who hold on to the truth, we don't want to offend them. That is the irony. And since that is the irony, they are coming and stealing our people. They are easily stealing our people. This evening, once again, I want to remind you, my dear brothers and sisters, they are stealing our people because our leadership, like Saul, has failed to stop them. Let me ask you, let me close with a question. In the last 25 years, how many classes have you attended against false cults? How many of our preachers have preached against false cults from our pulpits? We are afraid because many who lead the false cults, they are our relatives or relatives of relatives. And they have no such consideration. They are stealing our children, our members. Let us understand this. Take the arms. Fight for our children, as Nehemiah told the people, take the sword in one hand and build with the other let us defend our home nation. I thank the Lord for giving me this opportunity to present this. Lord willing, from next class, we will, in the coming class, we have more introductory lessons, such as the characteristics of these things that is essential because we before we go into study of individual cults. And here and there, I will pick up individual cults for keeping the interest up. Is Brother Godly?
Dear friends, I am confident that you enjoyed listening to this question answer video by Dr. Johnson C. Philip. He would love to get your questions. Please post your questions in the comment box below this video and he will prepare a video reply for you. Please post only one question at a time, and make it as detailed as possible so that Dr. Philip has no problem in understanding exactly what you mean. Also, please encourage this ministry by subscribing to this channel. Below this video, there is a subscribe button. Please click it. Also, please click the bell icon near it to complete the process of subscribing. Thank you very much for being such an encouragement to our channel.